Hi guys, and welcome back to my channel. Hope you are having a great day today. Today I'm back with two stories. Both are long, so listen till the end to hear my comments and update. First story is a crazy one. It's about OP and her family having to deal with OP's brother's crazy fiance. Listen to the story, guys. It's a good one. Enjoy the stories, and don't forget to like and subscribe. And of course, don't forget to leave a comment. Sorry if this is jumbled, but okay. I have four brothers, and I am smack dab in the middle of them. But this post is mainly about my brother Adam, 22 male, and his fiance Emily, who have been dating now for 4 years and engaged for like a week. The short version here is that my mom hates Emily, and Emily hates my mom. Both my mom and Adam come to me for advice on dealing with the situation because I am fairly neutral in this whole event. Basically, Emily got off to a bad start with my mom. Now, I love my mother, but she has severe OCD and anxiety, so I know she can be hard to deal with. But Adam has started excusing Emily's bad behavior as just my mom being ridiculous, and I think that isn't fair. The first time Emily met my parents and myself was over the reading week of university. I was home from school, as was Adam. The brother between Adam and I, Charlie, was not around. As far as meeting our family could go, it was pretty relaxed. So Emily came over for dinner. The first thing she did was tell my brother, "We need to go to our room." They did. And when they came back down, she was wearing a pair of his boxers and one of his hoodies. Not exactly normal behavior for the first time meeting your boyfriend's parents / being in their house. But we were all willing to move past it. She spent the entire evening curled up on the couch in the fetal position. She didn't answer direct questions, would cry occasionally, and then whisper in Adam's ear and then run upstairs. My parents and I asked numerous times if she was okay, and every time, Adam said she was just tired. After dinner, which she barely touched, she went upstairs, changed back into her clothes, and left without saying thank you or goodbye. Not a great start. This is pretty much how she behaves 100% of the time. Like, I have never seen her without her whispering to my brother and running off sobbing. Every time she has come over for dinner or any major family holiday, she refuses to speak to anyone except Adam and leaves without saying thank you or goodbye. As you can imagine, my mother doesn't like her very much. While she's never been outright mean to Emily, she has had long sit-down talks with Adam multiple times about how she wants him to break up with her. I know, bad idea. Adam, because he apparently has no tact, has shared these talks with Emily, and has likewise shared Emily's opinion that my mother's a witch with my mother. Things have recently come to a head in 2 points. Emily graduated and got a job decently far away. It's about a 3-hour drive. Since Adam still lives at home, when they wanted to see each other, she came to stay at my parents' place as to not disturb her roommates. The problem here is that Emily is a bad house guest. She makes herself food and leaves all the dishes beside the sink without washing any of them, and leaves them for hours on end, not just a few minutes. She'd buy takeout, bring it over, and leave the food upstairs, uneaten, until my mother found it and threw it away. She, for some absolutely bizarre reason, used 2 towels when she showered, and instead of hanging them up afterward, put them on the mattress and then made the bed on top of them, so that the towels were under the sheets and duvet, balled up and soaking wet. Emily stays in my old room when she's there because Adam's room only has a single bed. Emily also helps herself to my mom's closet, borrowing jewelry, clothes, and shoes without asking. All of these things had been discussed both with her and with Adam multiple times. Adam made excuses for her behavior, while Emily cried and apologized and promised not to do it again. As I said, mom has OCD, so mildew on the mattress, moldy food, built-up dirty dishes, and stolen items stress her right out. After a particularly stressful weekend where my mom thought she had misplaced a family heirloom, it turned out that Emily had taken it without asking to wear to a party and didn't apologize or explain, just started crying and then ran away and went home. So my mother told Adam that Emily was no longer welcome as an overnight guest since she's been so disrespectful. That was back in July. Emily took this to heart and now refusing to participate in any family events. We had a big family barbecue in August because my two older brothers and my dad have birthdays close together. So all us kids, my parents, my grandparents, and of course, significant others. Emily refused to attend because our mother hates her. She has been invited to dinner numerous times, which she refused to attend. She told Adam she refuses to come to Thanksgiving. You get the idea. The problem is that this isn't helping her relationship with the family at all. Everyone was already tired of her behavior, mostly in an eye-rolling kind of way. But now they're getting pretty annoyed. Adam is firmly on her side through everything, which is great for her. But it means there's a growing rift in the family when he refuses to come to events, or he can't watch the dog so my parents can go visit my older brother for a weekend because he's tired of their crap. As a side note, Adam does not pay rent or any expenses to my parents. They also pay for his schooling and his car. When he started dating Emily, she convinced him to stop doing chores around the house because, and I quote, "he's not their slave." This attitude has only increased since the rift. So now on to the major problem, the wedding. Adam proposed to Emily last week. She said yes. He called my parents. They congratulated him and told him they were excited. For some context here, my parents had always told us that they wouldn't pay for any of our weddings in order to keep things as fair as possible because they simply couldn't afford to. They chipped in some money to my older brother's weddings, but they didn't nearly pay for all of it. Adam asked my parents to pay for his wedding in its entirety. They told him no. They don't have the money to pay for the wedding he's describing, since he and Emily have decided they want their budget to be $120,000, but especially not as they're putting him through school at the moment. Adam and Emily flipped out. They said this was the last straw. That if my parents didn't pay for the wedding, they would be going no contact for the rest of their lives. So that brings up to where we are now. Emily and Adam will only speak to me. Emily has very clearly been hanging out on just no mother-in-law because she uses phrases like shiny spine and flying monkeys, even though no one outside of my mother and I have ever spoken to them about their relationship. She believes that I'm the scapegoat, for some baffling reason. And she therefore will speak to me in order to try to mediate. For the record, I have told both of them that I think they're behaving like children, and I have told my family to try harder with Emily. I genuinely don't think her behavior is malicious. I do think she's just kind of dumb and doesn't understand why she's been perceived as rude by my family. But okay, how do I mediate here? What do I do? In my opinion, Emily is not right in the head. OP's mom might have OCD, but Emily is the one some poor kid is really going to need just no mother-in-law about later. OP should stop mediating and stand by her mom. Adam is going to have to come to his senses on his own, and that could take a while. In the meantime, family may lose him for a while. Then one day, he'll realize it the hard way. Maybe he'll be the one cleaning after her in their house, whilst she excuses herself with, "I'm not your slave," then sobs away. And what? $120,000 for a wedding? I hope the parents don't hand even a single penny over. Let the wedding happen at that budget and them paying it off themselves. My prediction? Adam and Emily's ship is gonna sink. I am divorced with two teenage daughters, one of whom will be graduating high school in the spring. Their dad and I divorced when they were very young and have actively and lovingly co-parented forever since. I didn't date for a long time. I kind of wanted another child, but I wasn't about to go out and just get pregnant for the sake of getting pregnant. With my career, being a single mom by choice would have been a disaster. A little over 3 years ago, I was diagnosed with premature ovarian failure. In layman's terms, it means going through menopause before 40. It didn't come as a shock to me, because it runs in my family, and given the symptoms I was having, I knew it was probably happening. I am now 38. And while I am not technically in menopause yet, it means that my chances of conceiving without drastic and wildly expensive intervention are slim. Fast forward, and I met the man that I am marrying next summer. Future husband was adopted when he was 5. His bio mother died shortly after his baby brother was born, and they were split up. His adoption story wasn't the rose-colored glasses, sunshine, and unicorn piss that people think of when they hear about a childless couple adopting. His mother adopted him as some sort of a novelty. Her husband divorced her shortly after and tried to return him to the children's home from where he was adopted. His life was a revolving door of stepdads, father figures, and her own delusions of grandeur. Hardly the stable life that a bio mother prays for when she places a child for adoption, or hopes for if she passes. It culminated when he was in high school and found out that his girlfriend was pregnant. He was ready to step up. When the mother had the child, he found himself barred from the hospital, not by her family, but by his own mother. She took it upon herself to go to the girl's family and convince them that he would never make a good father, wanted nothing to do with the baby, and to just give it up. He was a minor at the time. By the time he figured out what had happened, the baby had already been placed. I met his son's mother, and I can confirm the story. His son was placed for adoption when he had the legal right in that state to petition for parental rights at the time. End backstory. I knew he wanted children of his own given what he has been through. Adoption is out of the question, due to the trauma he endured with his own and with his child. I made it very clear early on that I will likely never be able to get pregnant. He insisted, worked hard to be a good role model and friend to my daughters, getting to know them and their goals and ambitions, and being a good friend to their dad. He proposed and has maintained that if we don't get pregnant, then I still have two beautiful, kind, intelligent young women to call my stepchildren. Enter his mother, my future mother-in-law. She started talking about grandchildren the first time we met. In fact, she has brought it up every single time we have seen her. She talks about finally becoming a grandmother, and she is not referring to my daughters. He has told her, both politely and in no shortage of words, to stop it. Yet, every time we see her, she brings up grandchildren. She has been told by both of us that we will not be able to get pregnant, and why? Her response, "But you're only 38. It's impossible to go through menopause at 38. You still have plenty of time." Finally, my future husband literally stood up and screamed at her, "You want grandchildren so badly? Go get back the one you threw away." It was absolutely awful. Now she is researching those creepy reborn dolls and talking about how, if she can't have a grandbaby, she'll just buy one. Despite being a mother through adoption, she doesn't see step-grandchildren as good enough. This is a wildly painful subject for both of us, for wildly different reasons. I never thought I would date again, let alone get married again. I found my match in every way. I think about our wedding and I get giddy, even if it's just us and two witnesses. But his mother is making me feel like a total effing failure. I should be able to have more kids. I can't. And now I am worrying that she will wear him thin and make him regret marrying me, and 3 years from now, I'm having to explain to a judge that we are divorcing because I can't get pregnant. Despite what I think about her, and believe me, his opinions aren't much higher, I would never ask him to choose between me and his mother. She's the only family he has, and I have given him many chances to back out if he thinks he will regret not having children. I feel like I am setting myself up for misery. OP's fertility is OP's business. It's none of mother-in-law's concern. The next time she brings it up, OP should just look at her for several minutes and then start talking about the weather. Alternative, the next time she starts in, OP should stand up, collect her things, and leave. No warning, no jade. If she is at OP's place, this subject is closed. No further discussion allowed. She says, but, OP says, this visit is over. Then OP should hand her her coat and bag, show her the door. OP should never discuss this with her again. Update. And now the story continues. Fast forward to his early 20s. He was dating a girl from school. She became pregnant. Then, early in the pregnancy, she announced that she had been cheating on him, that the child wasn't his, and suddenly moved on. A DNA test was ordered, and his mom, no surprise, was the one to present the results that he was not the father. That was 12 years ago. I knew about this. Cue last week, when a 12-year-old boy reached out to my future husband over social media, and then to me when he didn't respond right away. followed by photos of my future husband with his ex all those years ago, and a little boy that was a carbon copy of my future husband. After a few conversations with the boy's mother, my future husband learned that my future mother-in-law, upon learning about the pregnancy, approached the mother with documents that said that she had power of attorney and that he was signing away his paternal rights, made all kinds of threats of taking legal action if she contacted them, and threats of lawsuits if she told anyone that he was the father, along with letters stating, "You aren't going to ruin my son's life." He also found out that she had many times tried to contact him only to be blocked by future mother-in-law, who continued to make the same threats. All of the documents that future mother-in-law sent to the mom had future mother-in-law's signature, not my future husband's. His mother has never had, nor will she ever have, power of attorney. This past week has been like a bad soap opera. Future husband has gone no contact with future mother-in-law while we start trying to get a lawyer on retainer and arrange for a paternity test. Future mother-in-law has no idea what kind of hell she has set her son up for. Future husband is absolutely devastated. His exact words were, "I'm a deadbeat dad," even though he knows that's not true. He was cheated out of 12 years with his son. He is worried about the money. His son's mom has not mentioned money yet, but he very well could find himself getting sacked with 12 years of back child support by the court. We were supposed to be getting married in June. That is now on hold. We weren't planning a big wedding, so postponing it isn't the issue. I'm also reeling. My sons are nearly grown, 16 and 18, and now I very well could be gaining a stepson, plus having to contribute household funds to child support payments. That wasn't something I signed up for when I said yes, but that is now the new reality I am facing. I am trying to be supportive in every way I know how. I've seen a lot of fathers fight for custody of a child, never for one that they didn't know existed until a week ago. All of this from a delusional woman who keeps going on and on about finally having grandchildren. A lot of people telling us to press charges, file lawsuits, get counseling. I'm sure that is forthcoming, but right now, this is really new. Our priority right now is to get a paternity test arranged, which can be done through the state health department, and to get an attorney on retainer that will take payments. We will leave it to the attorney to advise us if we need to or even can take legal action against his mother, either criminal or civil. Also, my future husband is adopted. This isn't about bio grandkids versus adopted grandkids. This is in no way a deal breaker. I've only been with future husband for 2 years. He didn't step up and raise my kids as one poster suggested, nor has he tried to replace their dad. My daughters have a wonderful, loving, involved dad. We divorced when they were very young, but we went before the judge holding hands, not lawyers. We have co-parented our daughters together. My fiance is not, nor was he ever meant to be, a father figure or replacement father. My future husband has, however, tried to be a friend and trusted adult to my daughters. And him having a son doesn't mean I am going to call off the impending marriage. It is just a shock. We had come to terms with the fact that I literally can no longer have children. I did always want a little boy. I just wasn't expecting to have another child that I will ultimately have a hand in being responsible for. Of course, that little boy will be welcome in our home, with every privilege and all the love that I show my own children. His mother is welcome as well.